Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Please feel free to get started on your lunch if you haven't already. On behalf of Cleveland State University, Playhouse Square, the Center for Arts-Inspired Learning, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum, the Cleveland Orchestra, Cuyahoga Community College, the Cleveland Playhouse, the Beck Center, Great Lakes Theater Company, the Cleveland Museum of Art, Idea Stream, and the Cleveland Arts Education Consortium, I welcome you to the 2015 Creative Voices Summit and Arts Education Luncheon at Cleveland State University. My name is Katie Shames, and I'm the director of the Center for Arts and Innovation at Cleveland State. The center is proud to produce and sponsor this morning's Creative Voices Summit and today's Arts Education Day Luncheon. Woody Allen has famously written that 80% of life is just showing up. I think his percentages were a bit off, but I do thank you for being here today for this important celebration. Your presence here today demonstrates our collective faith in the power of partnership and the shared belief that we can accomplish more together than singly. We are honored to be joined by Cleveland State University President Dr. Ronald Berkman. President Berkman has presided over the largest freshman class in CSU history and initiated the transformative Campus International School with its rigorous IB curriculum, the MC Squared STEM High School on our campus, and the Center for Innovation in Health Professions, which will house our partnership with the NeoMed Medical School, specializing in training primary care physicians to work in underserved core urban areas. President Berkman, please stand and let us thank you for your leadership. We were taken on an extraordinary journey this morning by the brilliant mind of neuroscientist Dr. Larry Sherman, who came to us from Portland's Oregon Health Sciences University. Dr. Sherman provided an entertaining and illuminating insight into the amazing powers of music on our brains. We couldn't have produced this morning's presentation without the inspired guidance and leadership of Dennis Knowles and Mike Vendeland of IdeaStream, so ably led by Jerry Wareham and Kit Jensen. Would Dr. Sherman and our IdeaStream colleagues please stand up and accept our thanks for your invaluable contributions. And the whole presentation was underwritten with the support of Leslie Resnick and the John P. Murphy Foundation, with Nancy McCann as its president and Richard Clark as vice president. We are honored that Leslie, Richard, Nancy McCann, and Dick Pogue of the Kulas Foundation are here with us today. Thank you for being friends and partners in our exploration of the arts. Today's Arts Summit is a one-day expression of a cultural partnership that occurs throughout the year, and my partners are most deserving of recognition for the quiet but remarkable work they do singly in their own organizations and collectively with one another. I would like them to stand and be recognized. Liz Clay of the Cleveland Museum of Art, Daniel Hahn of Playhouse Square, Marcia Dobrinsky from the Center for Arts-Inspired Learning, Pamela DePasquale, Kevin Moore, and Laura Kepley from the Cleveland Playhouse, Mary Grace Harrington of IdeaStream, Joan Katz-Napoli of the Cleveland Orchestra, Jason Hanley from the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and Museum, Kelly Schaffer-Florian from Great Lakes Theater, Ed Gallagher of the Beck Center, Amy Parks of Cuyahoga Community College, and Judith Ryder of the Cleveland Arts Education Consortium. The arts are, by their nature, mostly collaborative, and we here in Cleveland have demonstrated that working together augments rather than eclipses us. Imagine the progress this country could make if every sector, public and private, chose to follow this path. Thank you, friends. We are really thrilled to have Gary Hansen, Executive Director of the Cleveland Orchestra, as our honorary chair for today's entire art summit. Gary stands as a defiant contrarian to the notion that classical music is under siege. His innovations and accomplishments have made the Cleveland Orchestra the model to be studied and emulated across the country and indeed all over the world. From neighborhood residencies in Lakewood and most recently Slavic Village, the renovation of Severance Hall, which secures the Cleveland Orchestra's beautiful home for the future, new residencies in Europe, Miami, and Indiana University, and the amazing Center for Future Audiences established by Milton and Tamar Maltz, who are with us today. All of these innovations created during his tenure are bringing in younger audiences, securing the orchestra's long-term financial stability, and giving the orchestra an undeniable cool factor. It's been my pleasure, for example, to watch the video of the orchestra in their Cavs t-shirts performing Carmina Burana through all the home games that have led up to our current championship series. And I think that's part of the reason that they're in the championships. In recognition of all that you have accomplished, Gary, we'd like to ask you to come up to the podium to receive our thanks and this special recognition from Cuyahoga County Executive Armand Budish.
Thank you, everybody. I just want to take a moment to first thank you all for what you're doing for the arts and culture of this great county. It's what really makes us great. You know, we keep seeing in the newspapers how we haven't had a champion in this area for something like 50, 60 years. We've got champions in this room every day with what you do with the orchestra and the art museum and all the arts programs that are represented here today. So thank you all very much. And on behalf of Cuyahoga County, I want to just take a moment to give this proclamation to Gary for all the great work that he's doing today in this meeting and generally does with the orchestra, one of the pillars of Cleveland. It's really tremendous. The proclamation has a lot of very nice things written about Gary. I won't read it today. You probably all know all the great things. I just want to be here to say thank you to Gary for everything you do. Very much appreciated.
Thank you, Armand. This is a surprise and a delight. And thank you, Katie. Thank you to Cleveland State University. It's an honor for me to be here. It's always an honor for me to be here at this, but this is the first time I've been standing up here. I just have one quick thing I want to say, and that is that so many people here today, so many people across this community, have done so much for the Cleveland Orchestra that it has made not just possible for me to accomplish a few things over so many years, but for the orchestra to accomplish so much. And the privilege that it has been for me to serve our great Cleveland Orchestra is no greater than the privilege that it has been for me to be a part of this incredible arts community and a part of this incredible community. And I don't think there's any greater example of what this community has done and what this arts community has done than the fact that across the country, Cuyahoga County is recognized as being the county that does more to support the arts than I think any other county in the country. Thank you. That's because of what all of you did 9 years ago, and that what we're all going to have the opportunity to do again this November. And so onward and upward, I look forward very much after I retire from this job to being a continuing part of this arts community and to having maybe a little more time to enjoy so many of the things that happen every day in this city. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Special thank yous to Sarah Stewart, Barb Smith and her staff, Rob Spademan, and the wonderful volunteer Redcoats for making the impossible possible, and to the amazing Judy Tirigno, who accepted this job working with me just a couple of months ago and had no idea what was in store for her. Welcome to the Fun House. Provost Deirdre McGean's stated belief that all children deserve to learn about beauty testifies to her Irish heritage and brilliant mind. She, along with President Berkman, have made all of this possible today, for which I am eternally grateful. Thank you for everything, President Berkman and Provost McGean. Without the day-to-day support and friendship of my colleagues throughout CSU, as well as my personal friends and family, I would have abandoned much of what we've imagined and created here and retired to the Man of La Mancha home for impossible dreamers. And nothing you see or hear today would have come about without the leadership and support of Henry Goodman and Howard Meeker. Finally, to everyone in our audience who contributes to education and the arts through participation on boards of directors, volunteer councils, and as subscribers and patrons for performances or scholarships, you are the unsung heroes among us, and we humbly offer our gratitude for your many contributions. But given the serious issues facing us as citizens in this city, country, and world, I want to take this last minute to state the case for why we're producing this summit and for the study of critical inquiry, regardless of discipline. What's the value of a creativity-infused education? Why highlight the work of the young performers from whom you'll hear today? Is it to create more artists, musicians, and actors? Hardly. The work of the Center for Arts and Innovation and that of my partner institutions centers on teaching students to creatively interpret their own lives and talents. Consider some models, to me at least, of great creative thinkers. Copernicus, Einstein, Winston Churchill, Jonas Salk, and Marie Curie. These were men and women who altered our reality through great powers of imagination. We need to teach our children to live thoughtfully considered lives. A creative education provides a three-dimensional view. An unimaginative education is flat and two-dimensional. We need to learn to embrace the responsibly dangerous idea, to find out-of-the-box solutions to confounding problems. We often say that our hopes and dreams rest on our youth, but what tools do we provide them to attain these dreams? Those tools, in fact, are already within them, in their own imaginations. I saw the angel in the marble and carved him until I set him free, wrote Michelangelo. There are millions of angels waiting to be set free in the minds of our children if we, as their parents, teachers, and art supporters, work to encourage the imagination. Our educational system today seems to value the importance of answers, but where is the emphasis on learning to question, to ask why or why not? Therefore, I urge you to regard the work of my partner institutions as vital to the long-term health of this community and this nation. Nurturing creative thinkers brings its own rewards. Plutarch, the ancient Greek historian, said that the mind is not a vessel to be filled, but a fire to be kindled. Each discipline deserves, indeed demands, to be taught in a manner that invites questioning and exploration. Think of where science, medicine, and industry would be, or especially could be, without an emphasis on creative and critical inquiry, that aha moment that comes with a new discovery. That is the work of the Center for Arts and Innovation and my arts partners in our day-to-day business. Sometimes it just helps to hear a mission rearticulated. So Woody and Alan and I thank you for showing up today and invite you to join with us in supporting the work of the imagination, the creation of the heretofore unknown, the terrifying but critical questions. Our collective future depends on it. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is JoJo Carsopolo, and I am the Executive Director of Dancing Classrooms Northeast Ohio. We are thrilled to be here today because Dancing Classrooms is working with 5th and 8th grade students all throughout Northeast Ohio. And Dancing Classrooms' mission and goals is actually not about the dance, but for us, dance, ballroom dance specifically, is the tool that we use to teach young ladies and gentlemen to physically connect in a respectful, meaningful way and work together to achieve a common goal, which happens to be the dance step being taught. So yes, we are working in schools all throughout Northeast Ohio, but we are thrilled to include Campus International as one of those schools. And I'm also thrilled to tell you that we have a group of Dancing Classrooms fifth graders here from Campus International here today to dance for you. So I ask you, would you like to see some dancing? Say yes. Then please join me in welcoming these fifth grade students from Campus International. Thank you.
Yes, you're lovely with your smile so warm and your cheeks so soft. There is nothing for me but to love you and the way you look tonight.
Desde que tú me engañaste, tengo el corazón de acero y de mis labios no sale decirte ya que te quiero. Y aunque llores y te mueras de pena y te arrastres de dolor y de queja, no me apena, no me apena.
One, two. 1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on. Join me, hon. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. We're gonna rock, rock, rock.
Let's hear it again for Dancing Classrooms and those students from Campus International. My name is Daniel Hahn. I'm the Vice President of Community Engagement and Education for Playhouse Square. There are 321 million people in the United States. Among them, approximately 1 million are blind. And so Playhouse Square offers audio-described performances to make them more accessible. Approximately 1.3 million are deaf, and so we offer sign-interpreted performances. Approximately 2.8 million folks are seated in wheelchairs, so there are wheelchair-accessible ramps throughout our facility. You probably came up one to be on our stage tonight. There are 4 million individuals on the autism spectrum. What might we do to serve this population? Well, the featured video today speaks to that question.
All right, Paige, whenever you're ready.
Friends, can you say who?
Can you see the house lights that are on the audience?
Spell. Great.
So if you would do this for me, just take your bow and help guide the children off stage.
Havana Hop is the story of Yayla. Yayla needs more confidence as a dancer. And in taking that trip, on that journey, Yayla finds herself, her roots, what her culture and tradition is, as well as her ultimate confidence.
Havana Hop was a unique type of performance. We all worked together to modify the performance so that it was specifically geared for individuals with developmental disabilities.
For a sensory-friendly performance from a stage perspective, there are a few things that you'll notice right away that are different. When you're in the theater, the house lights will remain on, dimly lit, throughout the entire performance. The back of the audience, you'll see that the doors remain open. The sound volume for the cues during the show is reduced to be a little less jarring.
So the biggest challenge about doing a show like this and adapting it so that it is for sensory friendly is really keeping that intentionality strong from the beginning. So I started writing new drafts where I could really find ways to incorporate all kinds of people.
I think that it's important at Playhouse Square that we're welcoming to the widest possible audience. A lot of us probably take for granted the ability to just walk into a theater and see a show, buy a ticket, come down to Playhouse Square. But for families or teachers who have children on the autism spectrum, it's anything but ordinary.
Autism have some difficulty coping and having different forms of autism, then there's also different needs, so it's very hard to describe, but what I can describe is for some people, things that are really easy to do for other people can be more difficult for somebody with autism.
What we do here at STEPS is create a positive environment. You know, we like to foster the students' creativity and talents, and we allow them to be who they are and while educating them. There's a lot of laughter, a lot of joy, and we feel like that environment is the most conducive to learning.
Soon.
And?
So.
Can you use soon in a sentence for me? These kids have so much potential, but they just need that guidance. We get so caught up in looking at kids for their disabilities, not their capabilities. They're just really cool kids. So I don't know who's taught them more. I think they teach me more every day than I teach them.
Leo, do you have friends here in school?
Yeah, Gus, Andrew, Ethan, Philip.
What would you like people to know about you?
I'm cute, friendly, adorable.
We tried to provide many enriching experiences for the kids. We never say this is off limits. So the sensory friendly performance is unique in that it's designed specifically for kids on the spectrum. And there's not that many options for the kids to go in there and for the environment to be adapted to them versus for us to adapt the kids to the environment.
The value of being able to go out is, it's awesome.
They have so much to offer the world.
To think that all of these things are in places for them to be themselves, it never happens. This is the one opportunity where they get to be themselves. They can scream, they can yell, they can get up and dance.
I think it's just always really cool when the kids can go out in the community and see that they're part of the community.
Amazing, you try.
This experience is so valuable. If you look at a typical child's development, they would attend plays. They would attend events out in the community. Some students with autism or developmental disabilities don't get to experience that.
Having this theater experience where everybody there understands that this may be a challenge for this child makes a really big difference.
We give them the opportunity to be changed by the arts by presenting them with a version of the show that they can relate to, and that's huge. I already know before it even happens, before the curtain even goes down, that it's going to be amazing.
This experience is really the realization of a dream. It's been years that I've been hoping we could perform a sensory-friendly work in our theater. At the end of the play, one of Paige's lines is, "This is better than any dream." That's exactly how I felt.
You know, programs of this nature require collaboration, and we had a great deal of help with folks from Cuyahoga County Board of Developmental Disabilities, our friends at Great Lakes Theater, who themselves have already produced two sensory-friendly performances, with more on the way. Milestones, Autism Resources, and University Hospital's Rainbow Babies and Children's Hospital. The last thing I want to share with you is that we are opening next season of our children's theater series with a sensory-friendly performance, and we're closing with a sensory-friendly performance. So we're committed to this type of work, and I want to say that one of the reasons this was possible is we had a gala back on October 30th at the Hofbräu House called Prost, and many of the trustees and our friends in the audience today supported that. The proceeds from that initiative made this work possible. I thank you all for your continued support of Playhouse Square and our work in education.
Hi.
My name is Maurice. I am now a senior, and I love barbershop because it's just, I love barbershop because it just introduced a worldwide variety of music to me, and I just really enjoy it. And my plans for next year are to be a lead in the musical Grease.
Hi, my name is Isaiah. I am a recent graduate, and I love the sense of community that we have in this barbershop. Like, it's really great. And next year, I plan to study vocal performance at St. Olaf College in Northfield, Minnesota.
Hello, my name is Graham. I'm going to be a senior. What I love about barbershop is just that the people that I sing with and the places we sing have really expanded my worldview. And I know that whatever I end up doing in life, music and singing will always be a part of it.
Hi, my name is Ted Byers. I am a sophomore. Barbershop has really, it gave me like a really good view of responsibility and dedication. I'm hoping when I go to college to major in, what's it called? Computer science, yeah, computer science. When I graduate, yeah.
Hi, I'm Ian. I'm also a recent graduate. These guys around me for the past couple years have really become my brothers, which is why this group is so important to me. And next fall, I'll be attending DePaul University in Chicago studying international studies.
Hi, I'm Orion. I'll be a senior next year, and I love barbershop because every member in this group strives for the same excellence that I do. And after high school, I plan on traveling a lot.
Hi, my name is Michael. I'm a recent graduate. I love barbershop because it's an awesome way to create unique harmonies with each other. So this fall, I will be attending Tri-C for film production. Then the following year, I will transfer to a four-year university.
Hi, I'm Grant. I'm a sophomore. I really like barbershop because it's really given me more experience in performing and helped me to become a more confident performer. I plan on studying film production after graduating high school.
One, two, three. This thing called love, I just can't handle it. This thing called love, I must get around to it. I ain't ready. Crazy little thing called da-ba-da-da-da-da. Well, this thing. Jellyfish, I kind of like it. Crazy little thing called love. There goes my baby.
Oh, baby.
She knows how to rock and roll, but she drives me crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy.
She gives me hot, cold fever.
She gives me in a cool, cool sweat. Ba-da-da, da-da-da-da, ba-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
I gotta be cool.
I get hit.
I get on my tracks, take a back seat, hitchhike, take a long ride on my motorbike until I'm ready.
Ready, ready. Crazy little thing called da-ba-da-da-da-da.
This thing called love, I just can't handle it. This thing called love, I must get around to it. I ain't ready.
Crazy little thing called love.
Yeah, yeah.
Crazy little thing called love.
Crazy little thing called love.
Yeah, yeah.
Crazy little thing called love.
Yeah, yeah.
Crazy little thing called love.
She drives me crazy, but she's the one I love. 1492, three ships sailed out to sea. The Nina and the Pinta and the Santa Maria. And as they sailed the stormy sea on that historic day, from way up in the crow's nest you could hear Luigi say,
I want my mommy.
Please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around. Take me back, I want to feel my 2 feet on the ground. Why you tell Isabella that the world is round? Please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around. When Chris took out his mandolin and he began to play, they sang and danced the terrans out until the break of day. Ole! They ate up all the provolone and drank up all the wine. But still up in the crow's nest you could hear Luigi cry.
Is that LeBron? Sorry, lady!
Please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around. Take me back, I want to feel my 2 feet on the ground. Why you tell Isabella that the world is round? Please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around.
And Columbus said,
I told you so!
Your journey's over now.
Then Luigi saw the Indians gathered on the shore. So he said,
whoop! That Sacagawea is hot.
Hey, let me get your number!
But still,
I'm gonna ask you just once more. Oh, please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around. The Indians are menacing, they mean to hold their ground. Woo! So if we land there on the sand, they'll boil us pound for pound. Please, Mr. Columbus, turn the ship around. All right, I'm chicken. But please turn this ship around. Around. Turn it around.
The nominees for best performance by an actress in a supporting role are Shirley Knight for The Dark at the Top of the Stairs, Glynis Johns for The Sundowners, and Janet Leigh for Psycho, Mary Ewer for Sons and Lovers, and Shirley Jones for Elmer Gantry, and the chosen of these is...
Before.
Beg pardon?
I'm Jenny. Who are you, honey?
Well, my name's John O'Hanlon. This here's Harley Sullivan. I just come up from Texas to take possession of...
O'Hanlon? Are you the late DJ's brother?
Yes, ma'am, I sure am. Did you know DJ?
Oh! Know him? Why, bless your heart. I hope to tell you I knew him. I was his favorite.
Sister, I was saved by him way back in Schoenheim, Kansas. Love. Love is the morning and the evening star. And what is love? Not the carnal, but the divine love. Oh, he gave me special instructions back at the pulpit Christmas Eve. He got to howl and repent, repent. And I got to moan and save me, save me. And the first thing I knew, he rammed the fear of God into me so fast I never heard my old man's footsteps. The next thing I knew, I was out in the cold, hard snow in my bare little soul.
Her, of course, from television and Broadway.
Beautiful or spacious skies.
Miss Jones, someone said as we shook hands, she was just Miss Jones to me.
then I said, Miss Jones, you're a girl who understands. I'm a man who must be free. And all at once I lost my breath, and all at once was scared to death, and all at once I own the earth and sky. And now I've met Miss Jones, and we'll keep on meeting till we die, Miss Jones and I.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the First Lady of American Song, Miss Shirley Jones.
Kisses, I think, oh, can I do that again? Hello, Cleveland. Hello, Cleveland State Theater. Hello, Director Shames. And hello to all of you for having me here. Thank you. I was so full of tears when the kids did what they did. I'm very emotional still, I'm sorry to say. Can you hear me? But that was so wonderful, I thought, really. I was very, very moved. You know, I have a bit to say about me, probably, mostly. I mean, what else can I talk about right now? Show business, yeah. And I thank you for having me. But it's a crazy business, you know, that we're all addicted to. And we are addicted, you know that, all of us. You know, Betty Davis, you know, the star Betty Davis. I met her once, and I always admired her so much. Some of the young people probably won't even know who she is, but we did the Tonight Show together once, and she said, Shirley, your voice is your ticket. Never give that up, and you'll be fine. Then, about 3 weeks later, I met Miss Joan Crawford, and she looked at me, and she said, it's nice to sing, Shirley, but you're not that versatile. You'll never last. That's the kind of things you hear from the other actors in show business, right? That's the way it works. Well, so much for the showbiz advice. Perhaps they were both right, though, you know. Although being right was never a big qualification for show business. I mean, that's for politics or stock market or maybe therapy, I guess. But show business is what happens when everything else puts you to sleep. I think, when you need to have something pull you out and say, hey, this is great. You know, I wanted, by the way, even though I could sing, I was born singing. It truly was a gift. It was a gift. I was the youngest member of the church choir at age 6. And I thought everybody could sing. I mean, that was, this is the way it works, you know. But my dream in life was to become a veterinarian. I was such an animal lover. I'm an only child. And I was telling my guys here at the table that I raised everything from, you know, chickens to snakes to insects to birds, you know, you name it. I raised them, had a whole array of animals and all kinds of things, and I loved that and still do, by the way. I own 3 dogs, but I've had more than that. So that was the thing that I really thought I wanted to do. You know, I wanted to be a vet. I wanted to fix animals. Well, I grew up in this very small town called Smithton, Pennsylvania. It's about 30 miles from Pittsburgh. I'm very close here to Cleveland. And I've been in Cleveland many times. I love this city, by the way. I've sung here and worked here in the past. But this, my little town, was population 801. Now it's 800. But I loved it. I was, as I said, I would get up and sing at the drop of a hat. I'm an only child, so my grandfather had come over from Wales when he was about 4 years old, and he came to this little town near Pittsburgh, and he went into, you know, he became a coal miner and worked in the steel mills and everything, and finally built a little tiny hotel in the town of Smithton, again population 800, and my grandmother worked as the housekeeper for 8 little tiny rooms. And out of that, he got enough to decide he wanted his dream in life, and that was to build a brewery, the Jones Brewing Company. And that was my grandfather's business, and we had it in our little town of Smithton, Pennsylvania. And I used to love to go down there and look at the river and look at all the beer things where they were making the beer. And my father would say, "Would you please get out of there? Stay." I was kind of a, I guess, a tomboy kid. I was a big mouth. You know, most people won't think of me that way today. You know, but I guess being an only child, I had to say what I had to say, and I had some school problems, you know, and some fist fights and all that kind of stuff. But I was okay. I grew up okay. Well, as I said, I could sing. And I thought anybody could sing. I mean, I thought that this was the way it worked. And but I still wanted to be a veterinarian, of course. Well, I went to this girls' camp when I was in high school. And I was about 12, 13 years old. And my teacher there at the camp. I was there for about 3 weeks, and I used to sit around the fire and sing for all the other people in the camp. And she called my mother when I got home, and she said, "I have to tell you this. I hope you know what you have here. She's a musical genius. She has the most beautiful voice I've ever heard at 12 years old." She said, "I think you ought to think about giving her voice lessons." And my mother said, "Oh, okay." So I started voice lessons at age 12 in Pittsburgh with a man by the name of Ralph Luando, and he was also writing for the Pittsburgh Press. He wrote all the musical reviews for the press, and he was a known teacher there. His wife was an opera singer as well. So I sang for him, and when I was about, oh, I guess 17, 16, they were having a beauty pageant in Pittsburgh, Miss Pittsburgh, on for Miss Pennsylvania, and then Miss America. Well, he entered me in the contest, and I had an opera voice. I was an opera singer at that time. And I sang an aria in the pageant. And I won the title of Miss Pittsburgh. Then I went on for Miss Pennsylvania, and I came in second. She played the piano brilliantly. So that was what happened there. But as I said, I could sing. And during my high school years, I would go to a place called the Pittsburgh Playhouse, which is still there. By the way, it's being rebuilt in downtown Pittsburgh now. And I'm on the board, and I'm I'm really a part of wanting to get that done. It was an incredible place for young people to learn and to be. I studied dance there. I studied acting, of course. Again, I say, I loved all of this, but I still wanted to be a veterinarian. and was in a lot of shows at the Playhouse, you know. I sang, they had musical shows, new musical shows. A couple of them went on to Broadway. And these were people just, you know, beginning their careers. And I had a wonderful time there, and I learned an awful lot. It was incredible. I learned how to dance. I even had to build sets, which was interesting for me. But that was how that happened. Well, here come the summer. I graduated high school, and I was entered in college to become a veterinarian. And my family always took me to New York on a summer holiday. That was our sort of summer vacation. And I went to New York and with my parents, and in the fall I was going to college to take care of all the animals. And I knew this pianist that I'd worked with at the Pittsburgh Playhouse, so I called him. He was living in New York. And he said, "Come on up, Cheryl, we'll sing a couple of tunes." I said, "Okay." And I went up and he said, "Listen," he said, "Rodgers and Hammerstein's casting director is having open auditions for anybody that wants to sing for them." Now you understand, I didn't even know who Rodgers and Hammerstein were. I'd never seen a Broadway show, you know. I was a little girl from a small town. I said, "Oh, no, I couldn't do that. I mean, I've never done that before. I wouldn't know where I was. I wouldn't, come on, give it a chance, give it a try." Well, I said, "Okay." I took a bus to the St. James Theater in New York and went in, and I saw all these people waiting in line to get on the stage, you know, with their music in hand. And I thought, what am I doing? This is unbelievable. Finally, I made it to the stage, and there must have been at least 1,000 people waiting in line to get there. I finally made it to the stage, and I got up, and my pianist played, "The moon belongs to everyone, the best things in life are free." That's what I sang. Believe it or not, that and a couple of other songs, but I sang that. And he banged away at the song. And the gentleman, the casting director, said, "Miss Jones, that was beautiful. Could you please wait a while?" "Okay," I said. Well, now he heard a lot of other young people sing, and I waited and waited and waited. It seemed like an eternity, right, that I waited. Then he called me up again. He said, "Miss Jones, would you sing again for us?" "Okay," and my pianist said, "Wow, what's going on here?" I sang two or three songs again. And finally, after this long, 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 long wait, from the back, I knew that there were some people back there in the darkness. Finally, this voice comes up and says, "Miss Jones, thank you for staying so long. We're very grateful. But we want you to stay a little longer. I'm going to call my partner, Oscar Hammerstein, and have him come and hear you." Now you understand, this is my first audition anywhere, anytime, any place. I was a little girl from Smithton. I didn't even know who these men were. You understand? I said, "I guess so." and I said, "I guess so." And I said, "And what's your name?" He said, "Richard Rodgers." Never to forget that moment. Well, Oscar arrived, and at that point in time, my pianist said, "Shirley, I hate to do this to you, but I have to leave. I have an airplane to catch." It was some sort of holiday weekend. And I said, "Oh my goodness, well, who's going to play?" And Roger said, "Never mind, we'll think of something." Well, he left, and I waited and waited. Down the aisle comes this very tall gentleman, and he said, "Miss Jones?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Do you know the score of Oklahoma?" I said, "Well, I might know some of the music, but I don't know the words." And of course, I'm talking to the lyricist, you understand. He said, "Never mind, I happen to have a score here." I said, "But Mr. Hammerstein, I have no one to play. My pianist had to leave." And Roger said, "We have the full City Center Symphony across the street. Now, I'd never heard a symphony, seen a symphony, let alone sing with one, right? They took me, both of them, across the street. I held the score in front of my face so I didn't have to look at them. And I sang, "People Will Say We're in Love, Oh What a Beautiful Morning," and "Oklahoma" with the City Center Symphony. Well, 3 weeks later, I was in my first Broadway show. And what a show that was, South Pacific on Broadway. I never got to help those little animals. It was the last 3 weeks of South Pacific on Broadway, and they had to keep replacing chorus people, you know, every few weeks. And the interesting thing about that for me is that everybody in South Pacific had at least one line of dialogue. We were not just singers and dancers, we were actors. Now, I'd studied some Shakespeare and Chekhov, you know, at the Pittsburgh Playhouse when I was in high school. So I thought, I'm ready for my first line on a Broadway stage. Guess what that line was? "What's the trouble, knucklehead?" Out the window went the Shakespeare and the Chekhov. Well, I stayed in that show for, it was the last, about the last month of the show. And then they put me into another show called Me and Juliet. And at this particular time, they signed me to a personal contract. I was the only person ever under contract to Rodgers and Hammerstein. And I never, by the way, was under contract to a studio. It was them. And then I went on to do my own thing, you know, after that. They signed me to a personal contract, and they said, "Miss Jones, we would like you to go into another show of ours called Me and Juliet, which was playing on Broadway, and understudy the lead." And I said, "Okay." Well, I did that. We went to Chicago, and the lead got sick in Chicago, and I got to play the show, the whole show. And while I was there, it was wonderful. I had a great time. It was one of their lesser hit shows, by the way, Me and Juliet. I don't think anybody even heard of it, because everything they wrote, you know, became hits right away. But anyway, while I was there, Mr. Rogers called me and said, "We would like to send you to California to screen test for the role of Laurie in the motion picture of Oklahoma." Now, you understand, I was barely 19 years old at this time, and I said, "Oh, I guess so." You know, they flew me to California. I remember that was the time when airplanes had beds. Really, you know, it took a long time to go to California then. And they had beds, it was amazing. I got to California, I stepped off the plane, I said, "Oh, it's Hollywood." Anyway, they took me to the set and they said, "You're going to do the test with Gordon McRae, who's already cast as Curly." He was already cast. I said, "I get to work with Gordon McRae? Oh my goodness." When I was 16, there was a show called The Teen Timers Club on Saturday morning, and I would turn that on and absolutely fall apart to hear him sing. I adored his voice, still do, by the way. I said, "Oh my goodness, I can't believe it." Well, I met him, I did the screen test, and after the test, the director, Fred Zinnemann directed, by the way. He was, thank heaven I had him as my very first Hollywood director. He was so wonderful and so great with actors, you know. Just didn't think of the screen, he thought of the actors as well. And he came up to me after my test and he said, "Miss Jones, have you ever worked before a camera before?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Well, don't change a thing." He said, "It's perfect what you're doing." I said, "I can't believe it, you didn't give me any direction." He said, "You don't need it right now." So that's what happened then. Well, 2 weeks later, I get a call from Mr. Rogers. "Hello, how do you feel about going to California and the lead in the movie of Oklahoma?" I said, "I can't believe it." "Oh." Well, we did the movie down in Nogales, Arizona, believe it or not. I was there for about 8 months. Took about 8-9 months to do a movie then. Came back, had a wonderful time with Gordon McRae and wonderful actors. And then I was still under contract to them, and they sent me on a tour of Oklahoma all over Europe on the stage. and I got to work with the original director who directed it in 1943. By the way, Oklahoma opened on Broadway in 1943 on my birthday, and I went into South Pacific 1953 on my birthday in my first show. Anyway, I went on tour. We rehearsed it in New York, and I'm sitting there with all the actors, and this very handsome man comes over to me and said, "Hello, Shirley. I'm playing Curly. My name is Jack Cassidy." Oh, Jack Cassidy. Well, as you might all know, we became very good friends, and we became husband and wife. And Jack was a brilliant actor, brilliant performer, and I adored working with him. I adored being married to him. We have three sons and a stepson. I have 12 grandchildren now, by the way, and I'm enjoying every one of them. So that's how that happened. And from then on, it was making movies. I didn't, Rodgers and Hammerstein, I did Oklahoma, and then Carousel came right after that, the movie of Carousel. And I went to Hollywood. Matter of fact, I had to leave the company of Oklahoma early and go to Hollywood to do Carousel. And Frank Sinatra was cast as Billy Bigelow. And I was thrilled to work with Frank, too. We did all of the, you know, the rehearsals. You had to rehearse like a Broadway show when you did a movie musical. And did all of that. Excuse me. And Frank was thrilled about playing Billy Bigelow. I mean, that's all he talked about. He was just thrilled about it, you know, as I was to work with him. Well, we did the pre-recordings, which is what you did there. They don't do it anymore, but we pre-recorded, you know, all of the songs. And we were shooting in Booth Bay Harbor, Maine. And I went up for the first scene. And I'm on a dock waiting for Frank to arrive to do our first scene together. Now, everybody in the cast and crew knew that we were shooting in two separate processes. We were shooting in regular CinemaScope and what they called CinemaScope 55. Which would mean sometimes we might have to do a scene twice, but that would be rare, probably. And but everybody knew it, you know. We were told right away. So I'm on the dock waiting for Frank to arrive, with the director. Henry King was our director. And standing there, and a limousine drives up, and Frank got out of the car, and he came over, and he said to our director, "Why the two cameras?" And Henry said, "Well, you know, Frank, we're shooting in two separate processes. We told everybody this." He said, "I signed to do one movie, not two." Back in the car and back to the airport. After all of the rehearsals, all of everything, the pictures, you know, the songs, and the producers, it was Phoebe and Henry Efron were the producers, married couple that did some wonderful things. And he came over to me with tears running down his face. He said, "Shirley, where's Gordon McRae?" And I said, "I think he's up in San Francisco doing a nightclub act with his wife, Sheila." He said, "Could you get him on the phone?" I'm on a dock with a payphone, right? And I said, he handed me a whole bunch of quarters. And I said, "Okay, I'll try." And I, believe it or not, put the quarters in. I got Gordon on the phone. I said, "Gordon, it's Shirley. How would you like to play Billy Bigelow in Carousel?" He said, "Give me 3 days. I have to lose 10 pounds. Well, that's how Gordon got the role. And I'll just finish this about Frank, because, you know, many times I would run into him and say, "Frank, what happened? I don't want to talk about it, Shirley. I don't want to talk about it." And, oh, this was about, oh, maybe 10 years ago now. I was at a press conference with some of the old guys from the press, you know. And they said, "Shirley, don't you know why Frank left the movie?" And I said, "No, I can't get him to speak to me about it. I don't know what it was. He loved it. He loved the role." And they said Ava Gardner was doing Mogambo in Africa with Clark Gable, and she called him and said, "Unless you get your fanny down here, I'm having an affair with Gable." So that's why he left, was the reason, which was a shame. But I've done some wonderful films, as you saw up there in the screen. I was very, very thrilled to win the Academy Award, of course, for Elmer Gantry. And Burt Lancaster was responsible for getting me that role. He had seen me do a television show called The Big Slide with Red Skelton, where I played an alcoholic sunshine girl in the Max Sennett era. and he decided that I was right for the role in Gantry. And Richard Brooks, who was the director-writer, and they were co-producing, did not think I was right for it. He didn't want me for it. But Bert fought for me, and I got the role, and I went to shoot. The very first scene I had to shoot in the movie was the scene, as you saw up there, in the House of Prostitution, where I tell everybody how I met Elmer Gantry. And Richard Brooks sat in his chair and did not give me one direction, not one. And I thought, oh no, you know, he's gonna, you know, I'm finished. I got home in tears, and I said to my husband, it's over. He doesn't want me, and he's gonna fire me. Next day, I didn't have to shoot. He called me about 5 o'clock the next day after seeing what I had done the day before. And he said, Shirley, I owe you an apology. Not only are you gonna be great in this film, but I predict you're gonna win an Academy Award. And I went on to do another film with him, and we became great friends. So I went on to do 25 motion pictures after that, and fortunately that gave me a career because, you know, musicals, I was known for musicals because obviously I could sing, but they stopped making them, and my career was virtually over. So had I not gone into television and then not had been seen, you know, by Bert and then got Gantry, I went on to do 25 motion pictures because no more musicals came up except for The Music Man, and then I did that later too. So now, I'm 81 this year. And I stop and I look back those past years since that fateful day in New York. Only one thought circles feverishly in my head. I sure hope somebody called that veterinary school in New Jersey to tell them I wasn't coming. Now, can I hear some of your questions, please? Yes, can... I don't know whether I can hear anybody. Maybe we need a microphone. Yes, we do. Do you have a mic that they can?
I believe, is this Mr. Gordon? Is this Mr. Gordon?
I finished Pitt in 1946, and I worked there for about a year into 48 before I left and came to Cleveland. In the summers of 46 and 47, they built a stadium in the middle of Pitt Stadium and did operettas for a week at a time. I saw Shirley Jones there. Was that you?
I don't think there's another third Shirley Jones that I know of. Yeah, that was me.
How old were you? Still high school.
Yeah, that's right. They were doing, I didn't have the lead in anything, but I remember I played a small part in a musical that year. Yeah, it's the only thing I did there. Yeah, how nice, you saw me.
Yeah. On my way.
Yes.
I have a question, Ms. Jones. There are worse things than being 81. You could look 81.
Oh, thank you very much. How sweet of you. Thank you. It's always nice to hear those compliments at this age.
Have a question back here. Once I jog over, one moment, please.
You didn't talk much about the Partridge Family in your TV role.
Oh, sorry about that.
How did that come about?
Thank you for bringing it up. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I keep thinking about movies instead of television. That was interesting because, you know, at that time, when you were a movie actor, all the agents and managers said, don't do television, Shirley. It'll ruin your movie career. You know, that was the case. And I was offered the Brady Bunch, and I turned it down. I turned it down because I didn't want to be the mom taking the roast out of the oven, you know, and that kind of thing. If I was going to do a series, I wanted something a little different. Well, then Partridge happened. And it was a musical series, and I was the first working mother on television. Yeah, that's right. And so I thought, wow, this is something different. This is something new. And it was music. You know, it was a musical family. I thought, what a great idea. What a great idea for television. And my stepson, David Cassidy, they came to me and they said, Shirley, how do you feel about your stepson, David Cassidy, playing the role in the show? I said, well, he's wonderful. He's a great musician, great actor. I think it'd be wonderful. Now, I was the first person cast, and I walked on the stage, and David was there to test for the role, you know. He didn't know that I was cast in the show. They didn't tell him. And I walked on the stage, and he turned around, and he said, what are you doing here? I said, I'm your mama. But we had a great time. Yeah, it was almost 5 years, and I had a wonderful time doing that. And for me, it was a very personal, wonderful time, too, because I got to stay home and raise my kids. They were school age then. And at that point, I have three sons. You know, I took them all over the world on movie locations all the time. I just didn't want to be away from my kids. And I traveled with them a lot. This gave me 5 years of being at home, so it was great. Yes.
You mentioned about looking back and recollecting all those great guys that you were there with, and how did Drew Carey rate?
He was a darling guy and a funny guy. He really was, yeah. Yeah, I loved doing the show. It was fun to do, you know, because he was such fun to work with. So we had a good time, and he said, are you sure I can kiss you? I said, of course, you know. And we had a nice time. I enjoyed him. But Burt Lancaster was the best kisser, I have to say.
Hi, Shirley, from the music teacher corner over here. You mentioned your classical training. I was wondering who your classical influences were, especially vocally.
Well, to tell you the truth, that it was mostly Broadway people. You know, I went to see a couple of operas, and I had an opera voice, I did. And all the voice teachers and people that I worked with said, Shirley, you have to go into opera. You have to do that. I mean, this is what you have. This is your voice. And I won Miss Pittsburgh by singing an aria, you know, from an opera. But I remember I was doing a television show, and this opera singer was on the show. And she was sitting in the dressing room, and I went back to her, and I said, she said, your voice is beautiful. I said, well, I'm thinking about maybe going into opera, but I'm not sure. And she said, don't do it. She said, it's very difficult, and it's not like, you know, like you probably dream show business is going to be. She said, I'm thrilled to be part of it. But she said, it's a very tough thing to do. So I decided I didn't want to do it.
We have a question back there.
Hi, Shirley. This may be inappropriate. I don't know.
Where are we?
Back here.
Oh, okay.
In the wings.
Nothing is inappropriate.
Okay. I always thought of you as being my mom.
Yeah.
Since I was growing up. But my question is, were you ever on the Carol Burnett Show?
Oh, yeah. I did it two or three times. I did the Carol Burnett Show, yeah.
So, yeah. She was really cool.
I loved her. Yeah, we're still friends. I know her very well.
Good.
She and my husband, Jack Cassidy, did a Broadway show together.
Do we have any other questions? Okay. Well, can you? Oh, there we go. Okay. I should have worn my tennis shoes. Shirley, I would, on my way over, like to ask. I'm of a certain age that Sean Cassidy was on quite a few of my friends' walls. Did he ever have a picture of me on his wall?
I'll ask him.
First, thank you so much for being here, Shirley. As an arts educator, we're often working with young people that are just dying to be a part of showbiz. So I'm curious, what advice would you give us to advise our young people about your sustainability? How do you stay in the business? I mean, you are
That's
amazing.
A very hard question because the business today is very, very different than when I started out. You know, I started out a long time ago. And it's a very different business now. You know, I have, three sons and they're all in the business. And none of them went to college and I was furious. You know, I say, go to college first. Get a college education, please. Because, show business is, come and go. You never know. And no matter what your talent is, you can be the most talented person in the world. But, and particularly today, it's harder than it's ever been, 25, 35, 45 people go up for the same part. And with television the way it is now and all of that, it's very difficult. So I say get a college education, then you can pursue the arts if you want to.
All right, thank you.
Over here. My neighbor said that when he was a 14-year-old, seeing movies at school, where he would get 15 minutes during lunch or whatever to see the movie, he first saw you in Carousel. And he said that that movie changed his life.
Really?
The one song that changed his life was If I Loved You.
If I Loved You.
Is there a song that, I know this is strange, but is there a song that you have sung over the years that has meant something special to you?
Well, to tell you the truth, my favorite score of all time is the score of Carousel. And when I do my concerts, which I'm still doing, not with the voice I have today, but I'm still doing, I open my show with If I Loved You, and I close with You'll Never Walk Alone. And, you know, I do things from Oklahoma and, of course, The Music Man and some other songs, too. But that score is the most, I think, the most beautiful score they ever wrote for me. And I love every song in there. I love that story, too. So I agree with him completely.
I'm a music educator. I played Julie Jordan in Carousel.
Oh, did you?
I was so excited in high school, yeah. But this is unrelated to that. I just had to tell you, though, because I love the score as well. I'm a music educator, and in my studio, I think the biggest enemy for my students is nerves.
Nerves.
What would you say as a performer, with all that of your experience, is a solution for getting over nerves?
You know, it's a funny thing about me. I never had that kind of feeling. I mean, yes, if I had to go to an audition, of course, I was, you know, nervous about it. But I was never one of those people that said, oh, what am I going to do if I don't get it? What am I going to do? I'll kill myself. That was not me at all. I'd say, well, I hope I do a good job. If I don't, so what? I mean, that's really the way I felt. And I think, you know, you have to kind of have that attitude, certainly in show business, more than any other business maybe, because, you know, it's so, you never know. You can have be the most talented person in the world and still not get the job. And they have to understand that it has nothing to do with your talent or your beauty or anything else. It has to do with whatever is needed and wanted at the time.
Ms. Jones, thank you for being here in Cleveland.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask you, with us being a more mature crowd and there being so many young people in the city who are not able to be here, what would you say to us who feel some entitlement to our positions and some exclusivity to our culture, to these young people now, to let them know that arts and culture should not be cut and they need to be put through that conduit and pipeline to help them broaden their scope and their imagination?
Well, yes. I mean, if that's what they want and that's their dream in life, it's like everything else, you have to work at it. And as I said earlier, I think you have to work at that dream maybe more than any other dream that you have. If you want to be a doctor or a lawyer or, you know, any other occupation, in many ways, that's a lot easier. Show business, as I said, you never know. You can be the best at everything, and it just depends if you're at the right place at the right time. I hate to say that, but that's the truth of the matter. But don't be disappointed if it doesn't happen the first time. You have to keep working at it, and you'll get it. You'll get it.
Hi, it's a pleasure to see you today. I'm a music student, just finished my freshman year, and
oh,
I was,
good.
Yeah, thank you. I was wondering how you feel about today's new musical theater shows, the kind of the new age things like Kinky Boots, things like that.
I can't stand them.
Me too.
Sorry. First of all, maybe I just don't understand them, I guess. That's probably most of it.
Hi, thank you, Ms. Jones, for being here. It's a thrill to hear you. I wanted to ask a question to get away from music as part of show business, music as part of our lives, and you mentioned very proudly your 12 grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Could you say something about how you interact with them around music, what they know about you, and do you sing with them? Do you do music?
Well, they, you know, they've all seen my work. I mean, they've seen my movies, and certainly the Partridge Family too. You know, I mean, they, and see my, you know, my three sons. Sean Cassidy's my oldest. Patrick Cassidy, right now, my son Patrick, is in San Francisco doing a little night music for 2 months at the big theater up there, playing the lead. And my youngest son is a set decorator, so they're all in the business, you know. I just say, you know, I'm grateful that they love to see me and love to see my films and see that. But again, it's as the young lady just was saying earlier, it's a different time now. And, you know, they love that music, but they'd rather see Kinky Boots. You know, it's true. I mean, the music is different. I went up to San Francisco last week to see Patrick in a little night music, and you know, that's Stephen Sondheim, whom I know very, very well. I've known him since we both started out together. But I took my husband, Marty Ingalls, with me, and he has a trouble hearing in the theater anyway, so I got him the things for his ears, you know. But he came out, he said, "Well, I heard the music, I couldn't understand one word. What were they saying? What were they talking about?" You know, because it's all sung, basically. It's like an opera, really. And so he didn't understand any of that. And that was a long time ago now. So it's, you know, it goes from time to time, I guess.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you all, by the way. This was a wonderful, wonderful day. And I love meeting all of you. It was fun. Great fun. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jones, for sharing your talents with us through the years. And of course, your stories of versatility with us today. We truly, truly appreciate it. Can we give Ms. Jones one more big round of applause? My name is Ed Gallagher. In addition to my role as Director of Education at Beck Center for the Arts, I serve as the current president of the Cleveland Arts Education Consortium. As many of you know, CAEC is in residence at Cleveland State and acts as a convener of arts education organizations, over 75 now, we count as our membership. And today's Arts Summit is a public face of the important work of the consortium that occurs throughout the year and continues to be a great collaboration for the public good and for all of us here in Cuyahoga County and some of the surrounding counties for arts education. We're thrilled to be able to be that group that brings so many arts organizations together. So on behalf of the consortium, I wish to thank our presenters and performers, many who are still over here. If we give our young performers some great round of applause, that would be great. We know that they'll be in your seats not too long from now. And I also want to thank many of you who are seated in the front, but of course throughout the room, the board members, our supporters, and the faculty and staff that are truly making a difference with the lives of many people for doing your work every single day to make sure that the arts remain important and a vital part of our community here in Cuyahoga County. I hope that you continue to collaborate with each other as we steam toward a very, very important date in November, because we will not be able to make it through that next hurdle without all of us really teaming up and making a difference. So I encourage you to continue your work in being collaborative and being creative every single day. I know as I stand here, it's a great vantage point to see some amazing people doing awe-inspiring work. So I encourage you to continue that, to make a difference in the lives of the young folks that you work with, those with special needs, and lifelong learners that need your work to empower them and to truly make a difference. So as we go forward in today, go forth and create and make a difference, and thank you very much for all that you do. Thank you.
Suspect, I am afraid.